Hello and welcome to Newsclick. We have with us D. Raghunandan. We will discuss disaster that has taken place on the railway overbridge in Bharat. Raghu, what explains such a major disaster and what explains why from 1913 the overbridge capacity has not been expanded, given the fact that the population, the number of people travelling has increased by such a high amount?
I think there's two things to be taken note of. One is the general increase in the population in Bombay and consequently the increase in the traffic in the railway system, which today has crossed 7 million a day. But the second part of it is, over the last 30 plus years, when the old mill lands were removed, the population density in the mill areas, which has now been replaced by commercial buildings, the population density today is about 7 to 10 times greater than it was earlier. In the mills, you had single-storied X number of workers in the mills. Today, you have high-rise buildings with 5 to 7 times the floor area ratio and that many more times the number of people coming and going. So, in fact, the footfalls in Bharat and Elphinstone stations have gone up by more than 10 times over the last 15 to 20 years without any commensurate upgradation of the infrastructure, including this foot overbridge. 15 years ago, a sanction was given to either the expansion of this existing foot overbridge or an addition of an extra foot overbridge, which would be at least 3 meters wide. The current one is barely above 1 meter. 15 years that sanction has been lying there, and no administration, central government, railway minister, nobody has done anything about it till now. So the question that you asked, what explains this, is sheer lack of planning, lack of urban planning, lack of response to changed demographics in the urban area, lack of creation of additional infrastructure in that area in keeping with the demographic changes, and as far as the railways are concerned, which run the system, complete callousness in terms of upgradation of the infrastructure.
You know, is it also the fact that the railways is focused much more on what would be called the high-end sector, the 5% traffic, which is the major corridors, which they've made super fast, fast and so on, and really neglected the rest of the 95% system, including essentially the infrastructure for these kind of metro projects? It's also interesting. They have added bogies. So the number of people traveling have increased, frequency has increased. Exactly. What has not increased is the basic infrastructure.
Exactly. And this is precisely, I think, the problem with the railways today. The railways has for long now been complaining about being forced to become an unviable sector and has put all the blame on the low-paying passengers, which are actually 90% of the traveling public in this country, which travels sleeper class or lower, or travels in the suburban rail networks like in Bombay. As you rightly said, all the upgradation that's taken place in terms of rolling stock, electrification of tracks, speeding up of trains, including locos, has taken place on the higher end of the passenger segments in the Rajdhanis and Shatabdis and Duronto expresses. This is where all the investments have gone because, again, for the railways, this is the segment which supposedly brings them in higher revenues. So they don't want to spend money on the hoi polloi, as it were, prefers to spend their money on the 10% of the traveling public who travel by the higher classes and have not spent any money on upgradation of basic infrastructure which carries the bulk of the rail passengers. Due to this and related policies in terms of favoring roads, road transport network, vehicle manufacturers, etc., India has seen the proportion of rail passengers come down from about 85% of total passenger traffic at the time of independence down to less than 20%.
Yeah, but today, Raghu, if you take the metro areas, both the metro that we are seeing as well as the suburban rail system, this is not what's happening.
Yeah.
There is actually an increase.
Absolutely.
And this particular accident is really the result of not keeping up, as you said, with the
Absolutely.
Infrastructure.
Absolutely. And in this case, the infrastructure, as you rightly said, population's going up, the footfalls have increased, passenger traffic has increased, but the infrastructure remains the same.
Because these are not really vanity projects of
exactly.
a Duronto or a Superfast
exactly.
and now the bullet train.
Exactly. And nor can you charge very high rates from daily commuters inside the city.
But you know, this is the whole issue. You're willing to build, for instance, roads, and nobody asks people to pay for the roads.
Exactly.
And you know, in cities, you're really not going
tolls.
To have tolls, all this kind of stuff. But when it comes to rails, you want the people to pay for it.
Exactly.
Well, this is a basic infrastructure for people to travel for the city.
Exactly.
And this is not something which should be paid only out of the ticket sales that you make.
Absolutely. And this is where I think this unholy nexus that's built up between the state and essentially a contractor lobby, which builds highways, and the automobile manufacturers, which wants to put vehicles on the road, whether it's on the highways or it's inside the cities, unable to be able to compete, making sure that railways and other mass transit systems don't enter.
Yeah, they basically subsidize automobiles,
exactly.
bus, trucks, and so
exactly.
on through all the basic infrastructure
exactly.
they need, while railways are supposed to pay for themselves.
That's
and that's been one of the major
mass
problems.
Transit suffers and everything else is getting supported.
Real issue has been now that the basic safety, earlier it was a question of amenities. Now we are talking basic safety. Rail tracks not being maintained. Cracks on the tracks of a very large number known as fractures, and those fractures are increasing and not being addressed or addressed in a much slower way than need to be. We saw disasters taking place in accidents over the last 6 months. And now this, do you think it's a wake-up call for Indian Railways, or do you think they still prefer to gloss this over and go the bullet train way? We are making a huge investment in the so-called bullet train, which we have discussed. It's really a vanity project. And this is the vanity project as opposed to the basic needs of the people.
Well, to answer your question, is this a wake-up call? There have been, I think, repeated alarms and wake-up calls over the past 15 years, but nobody has woken up. That's the reality. This is not the first, and it's not going to be the last. Rail tracks require serious safety audits and upgradation. An earlier audit report had said that close to 80% of bridges over which railway trains pass are in precarious condition, so you're likely to see accidents there as well. Apart from running trains, safety included, collision avoidance systems, no significant expenditure has taken place in this area, nor is there a concerted drive in that direction. So safety has definitely been sacrificed in favor of just somehow keeping the system moving. There's one point I think we ought to take note of also when it comes to safety. Among countries which run large systems, transport systems, railways, air traffic, India is almost unique in vesting safety regulations and guidance in the same authority which runs the system itself. In this case, the railways. All railway safety comes back under the railway board. So who inquires into railway accidents? The railway officers themselves. It's not very likely that they are going to blame each other or the system. So in yesterday's foot overbridge accident, they have blamed the mob behavior. They have blamed sudden rains. Everything except the lack of infrastructure and the lack of attention to that. The same with the earlier derailment that took place. In aircraft, you've got the Director General Civil Aviation, who certifies every aircraft and its airworthiness before they take off. It's the same DGCA which conducts safety audits and inspections and accident reports after an accident is over. There is no way you are going to be able to pin responsibility or have serious recommendations to transform systems if this system continues of having the same body audit itself and conduct inquiry into itself. This is unsustainable.
Anyway, Raghu, the reality is we all know what the truth is. Yes. In terms of accidents, the safety measures which are not being taken. Every railway officer that you can meet will tell you the same thing. This is not the best kept secret in the country. So the fact that they are still talking about mob behavior and rains is just another, shall we say, very weak excuse for the reality of what the Indian Railways today is going into. Thank you very much, Raghu, for being with us. Please keep watching NewsClick for further discussions on this and other subjects.